Hello, Adela.
Hi, Sana.
Thank you, thank you, thank you so much, Adela, for agreeing to be a part of the gathering, Wisdom through COVID-19. And so what I'd like for you to do, if you would, is just to give us a brief summary of what it is you would like people to know about you and the work that you do and maybe the role that you play in your community.
I'm never good at explaining myself fully, but I'm gonna try this. So I'm Adela Nieves Martinez, also known as Noble Snows. I live in Southwest Detroit and Puerto Rico. I am a mama. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to everyone out there too.
Mother's Day.
Thanks. I'm a traditional health practitioner, and I practice through the lens of African and Taino indigenous traditions. I think I'll leave it there, and everything else will come out through the interview. Thank you for asking.
Yes. Thank you so much. One of the things I wanted to one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you, Adela, is because you have a very particular lens, and I'm really interested and ignited by the traditional belief systems that you have exposed me to. So one of the things I have behind me is my drum here, and which you created a workshop where we were able to make our own drums, and this was like one of my most treasured possessions. And I love just having it, and sometimes I like to just pull it down, just hold it, and just be thankful for the animal that actually gave up its life for this drum. And so I don't take that lightly. And so those are some teachings that you helped me to become familiar with. And even though I'm of African descent, I was really interested in learning about indigenous practices from people who are indigenous to the Americas. So I know you've been playing your drum in your community. Can you talk a little bit about your drum and why you've been playing it and what you hope to accomplish with playing the drum?
First, let me say your drum is beautiful. Thank you for bringing it today. And I'll share mine too. I have mine right here.
Oh, wow. This is beautiful. You have it right there. Oh, great.
Yeah, so this one was gifted to me by an elder. So I love it very much, and it's the one I use to drum every day. So I drum every day at 5 o'clock in my community, and that's for a couple of reasons. One, to get out of the everyday, the material world, to come off the computer and come out from under myself and get into nature and connect to the land that I'm on. The drum, we know it as, many cultures know it as, the heartbeat of the land. And so that's my way of reconnecting to nature, to Atabey, who we call Mother Earth. It's also my way of breathing, right? Just breathing. These days are filled with busyness and screen time, and it makes my head foggy. And so reconnecting with the drum and reconnecting with nature helps me come back into myself. And then lastly, it's a way to have something with my community that we rely on every day. It's our routine. Whether you come outside or whether you can't come outside, there's something that's holding and nurturing you every single day. And so at 5 o'clock, I'll go and I'll drum, and then whoever can will come out and we'll have a physically distancing neighbor time. And then at 6 o'clock, we'll go on a physically distancing bike ride to be with each other. So it's really just about that we're here for each other.
Wow, that's wonderful. So you seem to be a very community-minded person. Is that something that you were raised with, or is that something that you have cultivated, or both?
Yeah, you cut out, so I'm gonna ask you to repeat the question.
I notice that you are a very community-minded person. And I'm wondering if that is something that you have cultivated or that you were raised with or both. And then I guess the biggest question is, how do you view the role of community in the age of COVID-19 and social distancing? I know this is not one of the questions that we initially talked about. It's just that it came from what you said. And so I wanted to follow up a little bit on that, because I think a lot of people are, when they're practicing social distancing, they're not quite sure how they could possibly connect to their community. And one of the things I'd like to achieve with the gathering is to give information that has a spiritual lens to people that they might be able to use in their own lives.
Okay, thank you for giving me some background on your question. It helps me think through it. So I'll say this, is that it's a good timing for this question, because this afternoon at noon, some of my community and I went outside to one of the big fields a few blocks away, and we did a video. And the question for that video is, what do we think we need in this time and beyond? Mm-hmm. And so we all went out and we did a physical distancing circle, and we all had our masks on, and we all created poster boards of what we think we need in this time. And that'll come out live next week. But really what we're saying is, what we need in this time and what we've always needed and what we will continue to need is each other. And so we're finding ways of doing that and then putting it out in the world so that we can connect to each other's hearts, right? Even if it's through the screen, we can still have an energetic connection. And we try our best to do that in this community too, and many in Detroit. Detroit has kept its indigeneity in whatever form you say that, or it shows up or is expressed. Detroit has been a huge example for me of what it means to stay connected to community and do so in times, really, when it's a place that's under-resourced and undervalued in a lot of ways, but the value is in each other. And Detroit has shown that to me and grown me. It's always been something that's been part of my culture and who I am, and Detroit allowed it to thrive. And I will say, when I say Detroit, I am also, because Detroit, when I came, was an 85% Black city, and it's about 79 to 80 now, that's who I'm specifically talking about, is the Black community, and then also the Indigenous and Latinx communities.
Okay, and the community where you live is it's a mixture of people, but there's a strong Latinx community there too, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. What do you think can come out of? I mean, you've talked about two really, really important things. One is connecting to the earth and being able to feel grounded and to be connected to wherever you are. And then the other is finding ways to give to your community and then to be socially connected to the community. What do you think, how do you think this will shape how people, how you in your community look at each other once the COVID-19 virus has been eradicated and we're able to go back to our regular lives?
Yeah, I think we've come to understand in even greater ways how much we need each other and how connected we are to each other and how much we like each other. Right? And there's so much about our daily lives before that we didn't have the time to explore or talk about, right? That we now have an understanding of who's the most vulnerable, who needs heart medicine right now, who is struggling with a child or who is celebrating and having joyous moments. We know all of those things on the block now because we have a moment to actually be and sit with each other. And if it's all, and sometimes that only takes 15 minutes, right? Sometimes people are outside at 5 o'clock for 15 minutes, but we have that 15 minutes on a daily basis or on an, on a regular basis. And so we're getting to know each other and understand each other and love each other in ways that we didn't have the time or the breath for before. Mm-hmm. And once you know someone, once you have a knowing of who they are, that connection is very hard to break. That's what's so important about this time. Relationship has always been the foundation of Detroit, of my Puerto Rican Taino culture. And it's always been something that we, I believe, as the overall people have craved. Mm-hmm. And when people have come to my block, they're shocked that this still exists in the world. And so if it's possible here, it's possible anywhere. And these are the times where we get to explore that and get to know each other and actually build the kind of connections that last long term and that can last lifetimes.
That's a wonderful,
that's my hope.
That's a wonderful hope. That is a wonderful hope. Now, is your hope about the community?
Sorry, the low riders in my neighborhood. Did you hear the low rider go by?
No.
No? Okay. I love them.
So your understanding of community, is it at all shaped by your spiritual system or practice? And do you practice a variety of systems? And how does it influence how you're being during this time?
Oof, that's a question.
Just take whatever piece you feel like you can respond to, that you feel you're ready to share, that, you know, because all spiritual systems, you know, are very intricate. And
exactly.
you can't really sum it up in one sentence all the time. And I guess what I'm hoping, because one of the things I really love about you, Adela, is that you always bring such a light to community. And ever since I've known you, even before you became a healer, or even before you started to practice healing, you were very much connected to social justice and the community. And I love the way you've integrated social justice with traditional healing practices. And so I guess what I'm wondering is, what is the thing that pieces those two things together? It could be a spiritual system, or it could be something else. It could be a variety of spiritual systems that you're utilizing. But I'm just wondering what it is that gives you the sense of yourself that you want to come out into your community and drum, that you want to build community even throughout this social distancing time.
That's a beautiful question. And it is a layered one. So I'll say the piece that's coming up in my mind right now is that it took me a long time to get to this place of where I felt comfortable enough to share it and share it widely. Mm-hmm. So although for some folks, and including you, Sana, who have seen me practicing what you would say after a few years after we met, those things were always happening in my life. Mm-hmm. And I have been in practice since before I was born. And my grandmother was teaching me traditional practices with the mixture of Taino and Espiritismo, which is an African-based indigenous tradition, both earth-based practices.
And that's in Puerto Rico. Was she Puerto Rican?
Yes, yes. Okay. Both sides of my family are from Puerto Rico.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we through my grandmother's experience, it was much more about keeping things in the house and keeping things amongst us. And then as I got older, I realized that there was a part of me that I couldn't share, that I didn't feel comfortable sharing, that was so deeply ingrained in me. Even if I didn't share the words, I was practicing it. And so I came to feel much more comfortable and confident about reclaiming, restoring, and standing in who I am and where I come from, while also respecting and honoring where others come from, what they've learned, and how we can learn from each other and still keep and maintain our own foundations. Mm-hmm. Right? That no one has to outshine, outweigh,
right.
out front the other.
Right.
And so that has been how I've grown who I am and what I have grown into. It has not always been my comfort zone, and I still struggle sometimes. I still don't know if I could bring spirit into a space and not offend. So I'm constantly finding the balance. But thank you for that compliment. That feels really great. It helps reflect back that I get to be in community with you, and we get to be in community with each other and still exist in our fullness.
Yes. That's so important. Do you feel, is there anything about the systems that you have learned that are helping you to cope with the coronavirus and death? I know I just happened to see one of your posts several weeks ago on Facebook where you were going through a difficult time, and you listed a whole list of things that you did to help yourself. Can you talk about what you were feeling? I don't know if you recall that post.
I do recall that post. It wasn't that long ago. I heard something that shook me so hard, and it was so painful that what I wanted to do was I wanted to fall under the weight of it. I wanted to spiral with the pain. Mm-hmm. And that felt like the most comfortable place for me to just be in that anguish. But I have a child. I have a life that I'm responsible for and work to do. And so I had to get out of bed, even though I didn't want to. It was so painful. And I'll tell you, Sana, there's times when my emotions, I'm so embarrassed of them. And so I had a work call the next day, and on that work call, I was still feeling so much of that pain. And I said to them, I feel insecure that I can't offer you what you need for me to hold in this time. And I almost broke down into tears, and I was embarrassed of the pain that I was feeling, right? Because I feel this pressure to master all of my emotions and move through them really quickly for the good of myself and others. And it doesn't always work that way, right? Sometimes it takes days, months, or years to work through an anguish or a grief or a pain. And so I was putting that pressure on myself. And so instead of completely falling under the weight of it, I wrote about it. I put it on Facebook for others to walk with me, to break up some of that. Like, I'm human and I have these emotions, and we all do. And I'm in grief right now, and this is what I'm doing, partly to help that discomfort, like to not have the discomfort constantly on my skin. Mm-hmm. And so I let myself be with others in a pain that sometimes can feel embarrassing. And so there's a number of things I did, Sana. I needed something almost every hour to get through the few days that I was feeling this pain so, so incredibly deeply. And the part of me that felt shame and embarrassment about not being able to hold everything while I was feeling this pain.
Well, let me ask you, Adela, was it something that, were you feeling what was going on? Like, were you feeling the pain that others are feeling throughout the country, in the world? Or was it something specific that, or was it both? Something specific that happened that you heard, or was it your, were you feeling empathic and picked up?
Yeah. Good. It was something specific that happened that relates to the greater. Mm-hmm. Right. So that one slammed me back, and then the reality of how big it is, mm-hmm, just felt, I fell under the weight of it. I wanted to feel that we can't, I was like, okay, if it's time to go, let's go. We can't be, you know, I wanted to feel that. And I let myself feel like, this feels hopeless. And what's beyond that? What's beyond that? So I put my hands in water. I put water on my face for 5 minutes. I had to come back to nature, an element. I put my bare feet in the grass. I got rose water and sprayed it on myself. I got sage and copal, and I cleansed myself, my house, and my family. I went outside with my drum that 5 o'clock. I matched the rhythm of my pain to the sound of the drum because I couldn't be in anything else except that pain. So I took the heartbeat with me. I got tinctures that Michigan herbalists had donated to Puerto Rico. And I said, you know what? I need some for myself too. I usually am like, here, I'm going to give it to everyone else. I need it for me too. And so I took some for me and I went to bed. I took a bath. I went to bed early and then I got up the next day and I went to Transforming Love Community, which is Reverend Shahira in Detroit, I believe on the west side of Detroit. And she has a love hour every Sunday. And although Transforming Love Community is not my spiritual practice, it's the place in Detroit where I have gone to, where I have felt the most amount of love. No matter where you come from, what you look like, what you wear, what you smell like, you are embraced in love. And I needed that. I needed Reverend Shahira. So I went that next day and went to Transforming Love Community online. And then I repeated it the next day and the next day until I was back into some kind of place of like, oh, I can move through this transformation, or this time of transition is the word I want to say, this time of transition, where I can be myself and help be part of holding others. But I wouldn't have been able to get to the other side of it unless I let myself really be with it. And that was a hard one. And I'm sure there's more to come.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. Thank you so much for sharing that. You mentioned that you have a child and you cleansed your child. How does she respond to being cleansed and how is she responding to this time?
Yeah. So I have a 3.5-year-old.
Three and a half.
I know, it goes so fast. Yeah. Amazing child, Nana Belen. And Nana has been in indigenous practice since she was born. So it's not outside of her realm of understanding, right? Every day we get up, we do our routine, we cleanse the house, we cleanse myself, Nana, their father, and then we cleanse the house upstairs and downstairs outside. So it's what Nana knows as part of our prayers, part of our way of being in the world. And so for Nana, this is part of what Nana knows. And this also is a time where we talk with Nana very, very honestly in simpler terms, but not watered down, right? Nana knows that this is a serious time where we distance, we keep distance to make sure that we don't get sick and we don't make others sick. This is a time to grow our own food and share with others. This is a time to take our vitamins and share with others. This is a time to pray with the drum, to be in relationship with plant medicine and hearts and share with others. And so we speak to her about it all and we let her ask questions. But most of all, it's about what we're doing that she sees that we don't put words to. So Nana has just really integrated fully into our lives. And what we don't do is try to instill fear. Right? And so this, because fear can paralyze. Not that it's not important. Not that it's not important, but this is how we talk about emotions in general, fear also being one of them, is that they're important. We acknowledge them, we be with them, and then how do we move out to the other side of them? Mm-hmm. And so that we can do what we need to do in response.
Right.
Right. And that's still a struggle for me, Sana. It's still a struggle for me. I'm unlearning and learning alongside Nana. But interestingly enough, Nana is, I feel like, more prepared for this time than I am. Right. She listens, she asks questions, she moves with those, she processes them, and then she does what she needs to do. And at all times, fun and good food are in the center of that. Mm-hmm. So I'm in a lot of ways following Nana Belen's lead. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to, as I said, my grandmother built the foundation for me, and it's foundational in all the work that I do. At this point in my life, I need to weave that into all the work that I do. I just want to give Nana the foundation that she needs to then be on her own journey. Not mine, but hers.
Yes, yes. That's wonderful. That's a wonderful practice. It's, you know, because I think for some people it could be challenging to decide what should you share with children and what can you share. And so it's wonderful that she was integrated and at the beginning. And so this is just what she knows. Well, so we're nearing the end of our interview, and we've covered so much stuff. Thank you so much for all of the wonderful wisdom that you've shared. And I wonder if there's something that you would like to impart about this time that you would like to share.
There's so much. I would like to have a part two with you, Sana.
Okay.
There's a few things that have come up, but I'm going to share what the Tainos say of this time. Okay. And this is not all Tainos. And there are many teachings and many responses for what this time is. And there's also the place of we don't know. Mm-hmm. We don't know fully what this time is. But for the Tainos that I walk with, including my teacher, Bibi Kukuya, this is a time of, it's said to be a time of the Buin Ael. And the Buin Ael is a cosmic egg. It's also considered water. And it represents the awakening of all humanity. It's the coming together of all genders. And it is unmasking the face of Creator. And so we're saying what we believe is that this is a time of a sacred awakening and that everyone has a role to play. Right? And so for me, as a light-skinned, as the indigenous will call it, right, I have a role to play in the restoring of that oneness and the balance, right? And others have different roles to play. Mine can be because of the way I look and the tables that I'm invited to might be a greater responsibility.
Yes. Thank you so much. This is Adela. Nieves, pronounce your name Nieves Martinez.
It's Nieves Martinez.
Nieves. Thank you for contributing to the gathering wisdom through COVID-19. And I'm going to stop the recording.